Okay. Oh. Everyone can hear me? Okay. So yeah, today I'm going to talk about, I do hear that high-pitched buzzing sound, so only when I'm over here. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about dopamine increasing macrophage susceptibility to HIV infection. This is, as Mike said, the work that I did in my K award and also the work I've done here in the R. So in the beginning, I'm just going to give you a little background so that we're all on the same page. I know most of you probably know this, so I'll try and go over it relatively quickly. So as of 2016, 36.7 million people around the world were infected with HIV. We know that HIV enters the CNS rapidly after infection, somewhere between 8 to 14 days after, possibly sooner. And the primary targets for infection in the CNS are myeloid cells, like perivascular macrophages and microglia. These cells are, well, monocytes as well. These cells are important because monocytes can carry HIV into the CNS. In the CNS, macrophages and microglia contribute to neuroinflammation, and they are viral reservoirs, as Mike was mentioning. Importantly, neurons are not infected with HIV. They're damaged indirectly through the production of neurotoxic viral proteins, inflammatory factors, and the generation of a neurotoxic environment. Astrocytes may be infected. They may not. It depends on who you ask. And the role in neuropathology is unclear. CNS infection leads to HIV-associated neurological disorders in around 40 to 70% of infected individuals at this point, although the neurological disorders that people are suffering from tend to be less severe than they were before the advent of antiretroviral therapy. And the prevalence of HAND is increasing despite combinatorial antiretroviral therapy. So for my talk, talking about dopamine, drug abuse is important. And the reason it's important is that drug abuse has been a major comorbidity in the HIV pandemic throughout the pandemic. Drug abuse correlates with risky behavior and an increased incidence of HIV. And drug abuse can accelerate HIV disease progression in the periphery. In the CNS, drug abuse in combination with HIV infection can contribute to neuroinflammation and alter the development of HAND. Whether or not drug abuse significantly accelerates or exacerbates HAND really depends on the study you look at. I think in the field, most people would agree that there probably is a worsening of HAND in drug abusers or with drug abuse, but there are some studies that show different information about that. For me, what's important is that drugs, all different types of drugs, from methamphetamine and cocaine, but also alcohol and morphine and heroin, exert addictive and reinforcing effects to the elevation of CNS dopamine. So dopamine is a major catecholamine neurotransmitter in the CNS. It's a major player in the reward pathway. It's also responsible for locomotion, cognition, and a number of other pathways. The actions of dopamine are mostly mediated by dopamine receptors, here DR. There are five different types of dopamine receptors that can be broken up into two subgroups, D1-like receptors and D2-like receptors. All the dopamine receptors are G-protein-coupled receptors. And the two different subgroups classically, they have distinct pharmacology, and that'll become important later in the talk. And the concentration of dopamine in the brain is regulated by the dopamine transporter and other dopaminergic proteins, like tyrosine hydroxylase, which is the rate-limiting enzyme for dopamine production. So an important question for my work is how much dopamine is where in the body. So the majority of dopamine in the body is present in the CNS, which is why I'm interested in HIV infection and macrophages and dopamine, because that is where the macrophages are going to encounter the dopamine. Dopamine is produced by dopaminergic neurons. Dopamine levels in the synapse in rodents during background or tonic firing can reach maybe 1 to 3 nanomolar, maybe as high as 10 nanomolar. And some people do think that it's higher than this, but this is the consensus in the field. In humans, it's not clear how much dopamine is present during tonic firing, but it's thought to be somewhere around this level. During phasic firing, when the neurons are responding to an action potential and releasing dopamine to carry on the signal, the amount of dopamine increases by a lot, up to 10 to the minus 7th or even 10 to the minus 6 nanomolar. In the presence of certain drugs like methamphetamine and cocaine, it can even be a little bit higher than this. The increased concentration of dopamine is going to lead to greater exposure of the cells near the neurons to dopamine. So dopamine is released by, dopamine transmission is volume transmission. So that means that it doesn't just go between two sides of the synapse. When the dopamine comes out, it comes out in kind of a volume around the synapse. And the higher the concentration of dopamine that is released in the synapse, the farther away from the synapse it will get at a high concentration. And studies have shown that with drugs like cocaine and methamphetamine that specifically increase dopamine, the volume of cells that are exposed to higher levels of dopamine is increased, right? And so that's why I study dopamine as a marker for drugs of abuse, because those drugs of abuse all will increase the amount of dopamine and increase the exposure of cells to this compound. So dopamine concentrations are highest in the basal ganglia, substantia nigra, and the VTA, and there are also some regions of the frontal cortex where it's high. Oh, wrong way. So In CART-naive individuals, dopaminergic regions, particularly those that I just mentioned, like the basal ganglia, used to have high levels of HIV-associated neuropathology. There were increased viral loads and increased concentrations of HIV DNA in those regions. There was elevated neurodegeneration and aberrant metabolite ratios. This was also shown in SIV macaque models, where you could do more invasive studies. They found aberrant metabolite ratios, and they found that if you infected SIV, infected macaques with SIV in the presence of high levels of dopamine, it was exacerbated neuropathology and also increased viral loads, which suggested that dopamine played an important role in HIV infection in the brain. In the CART era, there's still significant change in the regions that I mentioned, but the changes are often more subtle, and there are also changes in other regions of the brain as well. CNS dopamine can be increased or decreased in HIV-infected individuals. It really depends on the study you look at. Most of the studies that have shown decreases are post-mortem studies. Dopamine is not particularly stable, and so it breaks down fairly rapidly after death, and to preserve it, you have to do a whole bunch of different things that are fairly complicated. So I'm not sure that all of the studies that looked at decreases in dopamine accurately are portraying what's happening, but they also look at metabolites, and the metabolite ratios change in a way that does suggest dopamine decreases. So it's possible there's a decrease. On the other hand, people have looked in the CSF of HIV-infected individuals and found increases in dopamine. So it's also possible that dopamine is increasing in those individuals. Getting back to macrophages, we know that macrophages and monocytes express all five subtypes of the dopamine receptor and other dopaminergic proteins. And we know that dopamine modulates HIV infection and function in macrophages in a number of ways. This first one, that HIV replication in primary human macrophages in vitro is increased in the presence of dopamine, is basically what I'm going to talk to you about today. I'll also discuss the fact that the activation of macrophage dopamine receptors increases their susceptibility to HIV entry, which is why the replication is increased. Dopamine also modulates signaling and cytokine production in macrophages. This is something I study, but I'm not going to talk about today. And when I was in Joan Berman's lab, there was also a lot of work done on dopamine receptors in monocytes. This is work that I assisted on, but was done by a graduate student and assistant professor in the lab, showing that dopamine receptor activation increases monocyte movement and transmigration of the cells into the CNS. So before we get started on the data, I just want to go over the experimental methods that I use in the lab so you guys all have a sense of what I'm doing. The cells that I use in the lab are all primary human monocyte-derived macrophages. We isolate monocytes from peripheral blood mononuclear cells. We receive blood units from the New York Blood Center, use Fickle isolation to get the PBMC, and then we culture the PBMC in various different dishes depending on what we want to do. We culture the PBMC for 6 days in the presence of MCSF to generate mature macrophages. Macrophages are pretty hard to pick up, so you tend to put them in the dish you want to use for the experiment ahead of time. So if we want to do flow cytometry, which means I do have to pick them up, or we want to do Western blots or qPCR, to generate that, we'll put them in 10-centimeter dishes. If we want to do infection assays, where we infect the macrophages, then wash and collect supernatant for 2 to 6 days and analyze P24, we put them in a 48-well plate. If we want to do the entry assay that I'm going to tell you about later, I put them in a 96-well plate. So this is generally our workflow. So we collect the PBMC, isolate the cells, prep for all of the assays we want to do, and then the next week we run the assays and then we repeat. One last thing before I get to the data. A lot of what you see in this presentation, you're going to see pretty big error bars. This is because everything I use is primary cells, and every person is different. There's a lot of variability in primary macrophages. There's different susceptibility to dopamine, different susceptibility to HIV infection. That's what I'm showing here on the left-hand side to demonstrate my point. So on the y-axis of these three graphs, you see the concentration of HIV P24. P24 is the viral capsid protein, so you can use this as a surrogate for viral replication. You collect the supernatant and look for the P24, see how much is there, and that gives you a sense of how much was produced. Right? On the x-axis is days post-infection. These are three infections of macrophages from three different donors. They were plated in the same plate, infected with the same viral stock of HIV at the same concentration. What you can see is the trend of infection is very similar over 6 days, but if you look at the y-axis at the amount of P24 produced, it's very different from the three donors, and that's because these three people had different susceptibility to HIV infection. To deal with this variability, we do a lot of N. We use multiple concentrations of dopamine to try and hit the concentration that different people are susceptible to. Last note, dopamine is not cytotoxic. Some people think that it is in cell culture, but it's not cytotoxic in our hands in macrophages. So, on to the data. So the first question we want to address is, what are the effects of dopamine on HIV replication in macrophages? I've already told you the answer to this, that dopamine increases HIV replication in primary human macrophages. For this infection, again, for this experiment, on the y-axis, you see the P24 concentration. On the x-axis, you see days post-infection. In this graph, and in most other graphs in this presentation, the control culture, which is infected with HIV alone, will be in red. cultures infected in the presence of dopamine will be in varying shades of gray throughout the presentation, right? So in this infection, we took our primary human monocyte-derived macrophages, we added HIV and dopamine at day zero. At day one, we washed off the HIV and dopamine, and then collected the supernatant at days 3, 5, 7, et cetera, out through day 13, and then measured the P24. And what this is showing you is that in cultures where HIV infection occurred in the presence of dopamine, there's a significant increase in the amount of viral replication relative to the culture infected with HIV alone. The interesting thing about this is this happens out 13 days after the HIV was there, because the dopamine was there, because the dopamine is washed off at day one, right? So what is happening is that the dopamine is doing something during this time point that's affecting the replication all the way out here. So before we got to how it is happening, we wanted to characterize the effect, so we repeated the infection. These are similar experiments, but they're only done out through 6 days. Again, on the y-axis, P24 concentration, on the x-axis, days post-infection. And what you can see is, in these four graphs, we infected macrophages from four different donors with four different R5-derived viral strains. For people who don't know, HIV can infect cells using two different types of co-receptors, either CCR5 or CXCR4. CCR5 strains are more common, and they are the type that generally infect macrophages. Here we used a blood-derived strain, HIV-ADA, a brain-derived strain, HIV-YU2, a lung-derived strain, HIV-BAL, and another brain-derived strain, HIV-SF162. We see that for all four strains, and the infections were also at different concentrations, the effect of dopamine is the same. There's a significant increase in the amount of replication in cultures that were infected in the presence of dopamine. We also looked at infection across donors, because as I said, there's a lot of variability between donors. So what this graph is showing you on the left-hand side is the full increase in HIV replication relative to the control. The control bars are here in red, they're set to one. This is days post-infection. What this graph is showing you in the gray is that infection in the presence of dopamine significantly increases replication around 2 to 2.5-fold in 8 donors when you do the infection with HIV-YU2. Right? We've actually done this with a lot of different strains of virus and a lot of different donors, and the effect is the same. Finally, the last point of characterization is whether or not there is a dose-dependent effect of dopamine. And I was actually really sad to find out that there was not a dose-dependent effect of dopamine. This has caused me no end of trouble when I present to pharmacologists, because they don't think it's real if you don't have a dose-dependent effect. So it's worth talking about, and we're going to come back to the idea of a dose-dependent effect later in this conversation. But in this assay, what we see is that dopamine at concentrations ranging from 20 nanomolar up to 20 micromolar significantly increases HIV replication relative to the control, which is in red. But there's no significant difference between the concentrations of dopamine on HIV replication. So now we get to how this is happening. If you think about it, dopamine is interacting with the cells only for one day, and then the effects last 6 to 13 days afterwards. At least that's what I've shown you. So there are two possibilities to think about. One is that dopamine could be doing something to the cell that causes the cells that interact with dopamine to produce more virus per cell, and that's how you have the increased replication. The other possibility is that dopamine could be increasing the number of cells infected, and that's how it could be increasing replication. So what we wanted to do is test the theory that it was an increase in the number of cells infected. So we took macrophage cultures, we infected them with HIV in the presence of dopamine, and then at days 3, 4, 5, and 6, we fixed the cultures and stained for cell nuclei, which are in blue, HIV GAG, which is P24, which is in FITC, so green, and then actin to stain the outline of the cell. And then we counted the number of cells that were infected in cultures that were infected with HIV alone or HIV in the presence of dopamine. Over here is the control culture, the isotype control for the antibody to show no nonspecific staining, and this is a summary of the data from four donors that were done like this. These insets show only the FITC and the DAPI, because sometimes the actin makes it a little hard to see. What this is showing you is that in cultures that were infected with HIV in the presence of dopamine, there's a lot more green than in cultures that were infected with HIV alone. And that's shown up here as well when you look at the percentage of cells infected, suggesting that a higher percentage of cells are infected in cultures where the infections occurred in the presence of dopamine. This suggests that the effect of dopamine on HIV replication in macrophages is that dopamine increases viral replication by increasing the number of macrophages which are infected with HIV. So, how does dopamine do this? Well, when we started this set of experiments, it was unclear whether or not macrophages actually had dopamine receptors. Some people had looked at the effects of dopamine in T cells in the past and speculated that maybe the effect on HIV was due to the oxidation of dopamine. So one of the first things we did is we tried to see what dopaminergic proteins were present in macrophages. I'm only showing you a subset of the data here, but these Westerns show the presence of dopamine receptors 1 and 2 in surface proteins isolated from macrophages. Down here you see the alpha tubulin staining to show that the surface protein isolation was clean. This graph shows fluorescent staining of dopamine transporter in macrophages. This is the isotype control, showing no nonspecific staining. And this graph shows mRNA of tyrosine hydroxylase, which is the rate-limiting enzyme for dopamine production. So this, together with some other data that's not here, shows that macrophages express pretty much all of the dopaminergic proteins. What this is showing you is that the dopamine receptors are active. So here, what we did is we looked at the fold increase in ERK1 phosphorylation relative to control, right? And so this is a representative sample of the number of Western blots. This is the control wells that were treated with nothing. These are wells that were treated with sulpiride, which is an irreversible antagonist for D2-like dopamine receptors. There was no change in ERK1 phosphorylation with sulpiride treatment. Dopamine treatment increased ERK phosphorylation twofold, but when you add sulpiride, that is blocked. When you add quinperol, you also increase dopamine phosphorylation twofold, and again, when you add sulpiride, that is blocked back to baseline. This suggested that the D2 receptors that were present in the macrophages were active. So now that we knew the dopamine receptors were active, we go back to the idea that there are two different subgroups of dopamine receptors, D1-like and D2-like. And I thought, great, we'll just figure out which subgroup is involved in this effect, and then we'll chase down the signaling that's involved in that subgroup. And sadly for me, both subgroups of dopamine receptors were involved in that effect, which is odd because they have classically, they have opposite pharmacology. So these graphs are similar to the ones before. They show days post-infection on the x-axis and the concentration of P24 GAG on the y-axis. And the different colors correspond to different concentrations of either SKF38393, which is an agonist for D1-like dopamine receptors, quinperol, which is an agonist for D2-like dopamine receptors, or ABT724, which is an agonist for the specific D2-like dopamine receptor D4, because that one's a little different from D2 and 3. What it shows is that at all of the concentrations we tested, for each of the different dopamine receptor agonists, there is significant increases in HIV replication in response to treatment with that agonist when the agonist is added to the culture during initial infection. So this is actually really sad for me because it showed that all the dopamine receptors had the effect and we weren't really sure what signaling pathway to go after. In response to this question, how does dopamine mediate its effects on replication? We know that dopamine activates macrophage dopamine receptors in the presence of HIV. So coming back to the viral side of this, what stages of the viral replication cycle are affected by dopamine? So you're probably all familiar with the viral replication cycle. For the purposes of this talk, I'm going to break it up very simply into the entry phase here, right, which is when the virus attaches, binds to the receptor, fuses with the membrane, releases the viral core, and starts to uncoat. I will say the uncoating phase is about the end of entry. Then you've got reverse transcription, nuclear entry. You've got the translation of viral proteins and the formation of viral particles and the release of the viral particles and the maturation of HIV. In macrophages, this isn't exactly how it looks. In macrophages, the viral particles are formed in deep invaginations of the plasma membrane. People thought they were multivesicular bodies, but it's recently been shown that you can actually connect the membrane to those. And so what you have is you have a group of viral particles that bud inside the cell, and then that fuses with the surface and releases the viral particle, right? So we figured we'd look at entry first, because anything that affected the entry process would probably affect the downstream processes. And to do this, what we did is we generated virions that contained an active beta-lactamase enzyme by co-transfecting beta-lactamase BPR with proviral DNA into HEK cells. We would then harvest the virions and then infect cells with the virions. When they fused and the uncoating began, the active beta-lactamase enzyme would be released into the cell. After 2.5 hours, we then loaded the cells with a substrate called CCF2. CCF2 is a molecule that contains two fluorophores connected by a lactam ring. In the absence of beta-lactamase, when the fluorophores are close together, there's a FRET interaction and they fluoresce green. That's what you're seeing up here. So in uninfected cells, you see green fluorescence because of the fluorophore interaction. When the beta-lactamase is present, the lactam ring is cleaved, the FRET interaction is broken, and the cells fluoresce blue. So what you can do is you can count on the same day of infection the percentage of cells that were infected with HIV. When we do this in the presence of dopamine, we find that dopamine increases HIV entry. In this figure, what you're seeing are uninfected cells up here. Most of the cells are green. This is infection of cells with HIV alone. You can see a few blue cells here. But infection of macrophages from the same donor in the presence of dopamine leads to a lot more blue cells, suggesting that dopamine increased the entry of the virus into these cells. Simultaneously. I'm going to get to that. So I've done this now a lot of times, and what you're seeing here is the N of 42, so there's a significant increase across donors. The more interesting figure is here, where you look at the particular concentrations of dopamine at which this occurs, and what you can see is there's kind of a cliff effect here, or you could say it's dose-dependent, because there's a dose at which it works and a dose at which it doesn't, where dopamine significantly increases HIV entry into cells at 10 to the minus 8th molar and higher, but not at 5 times 10 to the minus 9th molar and lower. Right? To show this entry is specifically mediated by dopamine receptors, originally I tried blocking different subtypes of dopamine receptors, and that didn't work. And that's because both subtypes of dopamine receptors are involved. So what we then did is we blocked all subtypes of dopamine receptors using a pan-dopamine receptor antagonist called flupentacol, which we used to pretreat the cells 30 minutes before infection. So what you're seeing on this graph is the percent change in HIV entry relative to the control. And these are the different treatment conditions, so either 10 to the minus 9th molar dopamine with the antagonist, 10 to the minus 8th with the antagonist, et cetera, down. This is a representative sample. So what you see up here is HIV infection in the presence of dopamine. You see all the blue cells. And this is in a culture of this from the same donor, same infection, but this cell, these cells were pretreated with flupentacol. And what it's showing over here is in the presence of flupentacol, the amount of HIV entry is returned to baseline levels and reduced from what happens in the presence of dopamine, which suggests the effect is specifically mediated by dopamine receptors. So in the interest of what stages of the viral replication cycle are affected by dopamine, dopamine-mediated activation of dopamine receptors increases HIV entry into macrophages. So now we get to kind of the meat of the talk. What is the mechanism by which dopamine receptor activation increases entry? This addresses your previous question, and it was a really good question, and something that I really wanted to address. I wanted to know when dopamine had to be present in order to cause this effect, right? And so what we did is we infected macrophages from four donors with HIV ADA in the presence of dopamine, or either at time zero, so they were added concurrently, as I've done in all previous experiments, or I added the dopamine 30 minutes early, 6 hours early, or 24 hours late, right? What the circles are showing you here is that in the cultures that were infected with dopamine either at the same time as HIV, or treated with dopamine at the same time as HIV infection, either at the same time or 24 hours late, you have a very large increase in the amount of replication, something you do not see in the cultures where dopamine was present 6 hours or 30 minutes prior, which suggests that dopamine has to be present at the same time as the HIV for the effect to happen, which can give you some clues as to the type of mechanism that dopamine is acting on in order to affect this change. So the next question we asked was, is dopamine mediating its effects through some alternate pathway? Not through CCR5, not through CXCR4. Maybe dopamine causes the macrophages to phagocytose more HIV through some other pathway. And so what we did is we repeated our entry assay experiments. So this graph shows the percent macrophages infected and the treatment conditions. And we repeated them in the presence of TAC779, which is an R5 antagonist. So when you infect with HIV only, you get this level of infection. When you infect in the presence of TAC779, there's no infection. TAC blocks all infection. This is done with an R5 virus, which is why that happens. Again, HIV in the presence of dopamine, you have a significant increase in entry. And when you block with TAC779, it completely abrogates the infection, suggesting that whatever is happening, dopamine requires CCR5 to be present in order for the effect to occur. Yes? So it's been shown that dopamine receptors can heterodimerize with a variety of different G protein coupled receptors. It's certainly possible that there's a CCR5 dopamine heterodimerization. And actually, in my R01 application, I showed some immunoprecipitations that suggested that that is the case. But those are really hard to do from primary macrophages. And the results were reasonably clear to me, but I wouldn't have published them. Right? It's something that I intend to pursue at greater length. It's also possible there's downstream crosstalk. I'm actually going to address the possibility of dopamine-dopamine receptor heteromerization later and that role. I don't think that it's widely known whether or not dopamine receptors are present right next to CCR5. I haven't ever seen anyone who looked at that. I do know that a collaborator of mine, Jonathan Javich, has shown that CCR5 and D2-like dopamine receptors heterodimerize in HEX cells, but those cells have highly overexpressed amounts of the receptor. So I'm not sure in the macrophage if the effect is going to be because dopamine is activating the dopamine receptor at exactly the same time as the HIV, if the receptors are combined, if they're activated at similar times and the downstream crosstalk has an overlap, it's not quite clear. And I will get some stuff about that later in the talk, but that's actually one of the aims of the grant, is to figure out how the signaling mechanism is affected by these two things. It would have been easy if the signaling mechanism was that dopamine increased the amount of CCR5 present on the surface of the macrophage. That would have been simple, but that is not happening. And so what you're seeing here is flow cytometry data where we picked up the macrophages and stained for CCR5 and the IgG control either in the presence of dopamine-treated macrophages, either with dopamine-treated macrophages or in untreated. This is some representative histograms, and this is the combined data. And what you see is there's no increase in CCR5. So we know CCR5 is required, but dopamine doesn't alter its expression. I have some preliminary data to suggest that perhaps dopamine changes the conformation of CCR5. There are some people that believe that different types of R5 viruses from different areas of the body, for instance, the brain versus the lung, use either the N-terminal domain of CCR5 versus the second extracellular loop. And so if dopamine changed the conformation of the CCR5 on the surface, that might be an explanation. But those studies are ongoing, and right now the data are confusing at best. So there's maybe an indication, but I couldn't say for sure. What's that? Can you repeat your question? I'm sorry, I didn't catch the beginning of it. So in terms of CCR5 signaling, so people have studied CCR5 signaling in response to HIV binding before. I have not done it in this context. So I don't know if CCR5 signaling in response to HIV binding is impaired because of dopamine, although I do speculate that one of the things, so it's been shown that when CCR5 is bound during HIV infection, then that can stimulate calcium release. And I speculate that dopamine is actually acting on that calcium release, and I'll get into a little bit of that data later. It can. That's true. It can affect calcium in some cells, and that's one of the alternative pathways that I'm going to talk about in a minute. Right, so the way that I do that is I try to do that with epitope mapping using particular antibodies to CCR5, and I can't say that it's affected because the data are confusing. So I thought maybe I would get lucky and that the replication process was affected by both dopamine receptor subtypes, but that the entry process might only be affected by one or the other. So I repeated the entry assay using dopamine and then the D1 agonist SKF and the D2 agonist quinprol, and found that in fact, no, the entry assay is also affected by both subtypes of dopamine receptors. And worse, that if you added both subtypes, both agonists together, there was no additive effect. So whatever is happening to one subtype of dopamine receptor, that's enough to have the effect, and it's not there's no additional effect of adding the other agonist, which is odd. So now we're getting to the signaling part, which is something that Sanjay was kind of referring to later. So classically, dopamine receptor pharmacology shows D1-like dopamine receptors signal through G-alpha-S. They activate adenyl cyclase to increase cyclic AMP and increase pKa. And the D2-like dopamine receptors act on G-alpha-I to block adenyl cyclase, to block cyclic AMP, block pKa. So I thought one of the ways that we could address this and kind of define the pathway that I want to look at is to develop a cyclic AMP assay to see what is happening in macrophages in response to dopamine. So, treated macrophages with dopamine and looked at the change in cyclic AMP. What this graph is showing you on the y-axis is fold change in cyclic AMP relative to the vehicle. On the x-axis is the concentration of dopamine or the other treatment conditions. The orange bar is forskolin, which acts directly on adenyl cyclase and is a positive control for the adenyl cyclase function. What this shows is that dopamine has no effect on cyclic AMP. This was a little disappointing but not hugely surprising because we thought, well, maybe dopamine's acting on both G-alpha-S and G-alpha-I, and it's inhibiting itself, so why don't we try it with, but to make sure that was possible, to make sure that the system was working, we did another control, we used isoproterenol, which is a beta-adrenergic receptor type agonist, and this binds to G-alpha-S and increases cyclic AMP, and that's what you would expect, and it does, in fact, do this in macrophages, suggesting that the G-alpha-S system is functional, right? So then we decided we'll just use D1-like dopamine receptors and look at the increase in cyclic AMP in response to G-alpha-S. Sadly for us, there was no increase in cyclic AMP in response to G-alpha-S in the macrophages. This is SKF38393, which is a D1-like dopamine receptor agonist. We don't see any effect in the presence of concentrations from 10 to the minus 9th to 10 to the minus 5th molar. This is A68930, which is another D1-like dopamine receptor agonist. Again, no change in cyclic AMP in response. So this suggested that the dopamine receptors in macrophages are not signaling through G-alpha-S the way that you would expect them to. We went on to verify that this was not happening by looking at the activation of pKa in primary human macrophages. This showed, we looked at activation of pKa at 1, 2.5, 5, 10, and 15 minutes at a variety of dopamine concentrations. The concentrations range from 10 to the minus 5th to 10 to the minus 9th. And what you can see is there is no significant increase in pKa in response to dopamine treatment in these cells. Again, suggesting that the classical pathway of activation of adenyl cyclase and cyclic AMP is not happening. So now we know that this doesn't happen. I also didn't show you the data, but I have data to suggest that D2 is also not acting directly on G-alpha-I in this way, although the data are less clear, and that's why we're not talking about it here. So is there another mechanism? And this is what Sanjay was referring to earlier. There's calcium. So D1-like and D2-like dopamine receptors do have some common pathways. These in the past have been referred to as alternative dopamine receptor signaling pathways, and there's some that have to do with MAP kinase signaling, but we want to talk about calcium signaling here. So dopamine can bind to either D5R, which is a D1-like dopamine receptor, or people have shown D1 and D2R can do this, although now their studies suggest that this is not in fact happening. Mediate activation of G-alpha-Q, and then PLC-mediated calcium increase and increase in PKC. D2-like dopamine receptors can also do this, acting on G-beta-gamma with the same downstream pathway. So we decided to take a look and see if these pathways were perhaps active. What we found is that dopamine does activate PKC in primary human macrophages at 1 minute, and that's what you see here. There's a significant increase in PKC activation, about 60% increase at 1 minute. It's not seen at 2.5, 5 minutes, and then it might be coming back up at 10 minutes, but again, the variability is high, and so usually I do an N of 10 for these experiments. They're about halfway done with this, right? Another thing that we did is we looked to see how dopamine receptors could alter calcium release. So dopamine receptors can alter calcium release, but it's not clear. In neurons, this is common, but it was not clear that this could happen in other cell types. So what these studies show is these are HEX cells that are transfected with either nothing, D1-like or D2-like dopamine receptors. In these HEX cell cultures, you added acetylcholine to stimulate calcium release here, and then it added dopamine to see what happened to the calcium release 80 seconds later. And what these graphs are showing you is that when you add dopamine to cells that had D1-like or D2-like dopamine receptors, you can potentiate the calcium release that's initiated by acetylcholine, right? This is, you're able to block this by blocking PLC using the PLC antagonist 73122. That is the green line here. The blue line is the acetylcholine and dopamine, and the vehicle and vehicles for either vehicle and dopamine or acetylcholine and vehicle are here, and you don't see the potentiation. This study was repeated in the presence of D1 and D2-like cells using specific agonists for the D1 and D2-like dopamine receptors, suggesting the effect is very specific to the receptor type being used, and showing that, at least in HEX cells, dopamine can potentiate calcium flux. So this is what we know about calcium flux and dopamine. Specific activation of D1-like and D2-like dopamine receptors can induce it, and there are several mechanisms known for dopamine-mediated calcium release. There's D1-like release through pKa. That's not happening here because we're not seeing any increase in pKa. There's D2-like release through PLC and calcium, and both D1 and D2-like could theoretically do it through G-beta-gamma or G-alpha-Q, right? And so these are the two possibilities that we're thinking about. There's also a possibility that dopamine receptor heteromerization could facilitate calcium signaling. This has been shown by Susan George's group in Canada, but there's a lot of controversy in the field about this, and some papers have come out recently to suggest that is unlikely. So getting back to our alternative signaling model, remember we said that D1-like can go through G-alpha-Q, potentially G-beta-gamma, and D2-like can go through G-beta-gamma to stimulate calcium release. One thing to note is that CCR5 is a GQ-mediated receptor, so if you activated CCR5 to stimulate calcium production through GQ, you could then potentially potentiate it through either type of dopamine receptor, right? We now know that PKC is activated in these cells in response to dopamine, and we know that PLC and calcium have to do with dopamine-mediated calcium release, at least in HEX cells. And so now we're currently looking at calcium release in macrophages to see if this is also occurring. Coming back to the HIV and calcium release, as I said, CCR5 and GP120 interaction does induce calcium flux. This is mediated through the PIK2 pathway, and this mediation is PTX independent, which suggests it is not mediated by G-alpha-I. That goes with our model as well. There's a paper that shows that in an astrocyte model of HIV infection, viral fusion actually requires calcium release through a G-alpha-Q-mediated pathway that contains PLC, PKC, and PIK2, and that you can block calcium mobilization from either IP3 receptors or ryanodine receptors to block viral fusion. So this was a very promising paper to us. So we did an experiment where we inhibited ryanodine receptor-mediated calcium release. In fact, we inhibited all calcium release because we used a very high amount of the antagonist dantrolene, and looked at the effects on HIV entry. So again, we're looking at the fold change in entry relative to control, and then this is the treatment conditions. We see in our control condition, which is set to 1, we have some entry. Dantrolene alone, which is the calcium flux inhibitor that we're using, does not change the amount of viral entry we have. Dopamine significantly increases entry, and then when you block the calcium, it blocks the effect of dopamine back to baseline, suggesting the calcium is, in fact, what we want to be looking at. So taking all the data together, this is the model of what I think is happening. I think the HIV is binding to CD4 and CCR5 and stimulating calcium flux through PLC and IP3 through G-alpha-Q activation. We get this calcium release from the endoplasmic reticulum that increases HIV entry. In the presence of dopamine, which has to occur at the same time because calcium release is a very transient event, You have G beta gamma, or possibly G alpha Q as well, if the dopamine receptors are bound to G alpha Q in macrophages, because they're not bound to GS and possibly not to GI. You get this potentiation of the calcium flux by dopamine. The potentiation leads to an increase in calcium, and that increases HIV entry. So, in answer to what is the mechanism by which dopamine receptor activation increases entry, we think that both subtypes of dopamine receptors may increase entry by potentiating calcium mobilization. In summary of this talk, the data I showed you here, we know that dopamine increases HIV replication in primary human macrophages. The increases occur irrespective of donor viral strain or dopamine concentration. The increases are due to an increased number of infected cells and are mediated specifically by dopamine receptors, both D1-like and D2-like. And dopamine must be present concurrently with HIV to mediate its effect. We know the increased replication is due at least in part to increased entry. The increase in entry is dose-dependent. If you buy my dose-dependent argument, otherwise it's kind of a cliff effect or switch effect. Specific to dopamine receptors and can be mediated by both subtypes, and it may involve the potentiation of calcium release through the PLC and PKC pathway. So where do we go from here? So the future directions for this project, I want to break entry up into different stages and look at the effects of dopamine on the particular stages of entry. So I want to examine the effect of dopamine on the attachment of the virus to the cell, on the membrane fusion of the virion to the cell, and the uncoding process. And doing this may contribute to the development of novel therapeutics or therapeutic targets, because if you figure out a particular way that the dopamine receptor system, which is a system entirely unrelated to HIV infection, is affecting one of these processes, it'll give you a whole new insight into that process and potentially a lot of targets that we haven't thought of before. We want to look at the signaling pathways and host proteins that are altered by dopamine receptor activation. This is what I was getting at before. We want to look at the heteromerization and the signaling pathways involved. We also want to define the effects of dopamine on calcium signaling through this pathway, the G beta gamma PKC PIK2 RAS-RAC pathway. And this is something that is ongoing in the lab now. And then we want to talk about how targeting dopamine receptors can help HIV positive drug users. I have an animal model to do this, and I want to spend a minute talking about it now. One of the questions that a lot of people ask me is, okay, so dopamine increases HIV infection. So you block the effect of dopamine. People are still infected with HIV. So who cares about the effect of dopamine? I think that's a valid point. I think it's worth considering, right? I think the reason that you care about the effect of dopamine is that a lot of people who are being infected with HIV are doing so in the presence of elevated concentrations of dopamine because the HIV is coming in on a dirty needle or during risky behavior that is involved with drug abuse, right? In those people, the elevated level of dopamine in the brain would increase the amount of infection when the virus gets to the brain initially, which would increase the size of the viral reservoir by seeding a much larger number of cells initially. That has much poorer predictive outcomes for people who have much larger viral loads initially. And so that's why you care about this. So using this animal model, right now, we're just seeing if the effect I see in vitro is happening in vivo by infecting animals with SIV while their dopamine levels are elevated. Once we determine the effect occurs, we can then use this animal model to test maybe an idea of PrEP. If everyone knows, PrEP is pre-exposure prophylaxis. So if you were to add to PrEP something that interfered with the effect of dopamine, and a lot of those things are actually addiction medications, so something you might want to give to the subgroup that would be interested in this anyway, you might be able to block the effect of dopamine. So even if someone were to be exposed to HIV, they would not have a much larger amount of infection in the brain during the time that dopamine was elevated. In conclusion, from all of this work, we see that changes in CNS dopamine in HIV-infected individuals can significantly impact HIV neuropathogenesis through increased HIV replication, also through increased production of inflammatory and neurotoxic factors. It's another part of my lab that looks at the role of dopamine on macrophages' role in neuroinflammation, looking at the changes in cytokine production, phagocytosis, and chemotaxis in response to dopamine. I didn't have time to show that data today. We also know that increased dopamine may be a common mechanism by which different drugs of abuse modulate the development of hand. All drugs of abuse increase dopamine, either through the addiction pathway or through directly acting on the dopaminergic mechanisms in the brain. And different drugs of abuse, while they have different mechanisms, all have effects on hand. And so this might be a mechanism by which different drugs, like everything from marijuana to heroin to cocaine, all have a similar effect on HIV-infected individuals. Finally, the biggest conclusion I want to draw is the effects of neurotransmitters on the CNS immune system are important to understanding neuropathogenesis. We don't really know a lot about it right now. Dopamine is the neurotransmitter that I work on, but I'm also interested in looking at other neurotransmitters and how therapeutics that alter them, for instance, SSRIs, which alter serotonin, or tricyclic antidepressants, which change the amount of dopamine, change the way your immune system responds to neurological insult. So I want to acknowledge my lab. Emily and Rachel are my graduate students. Emily actually works on the entry assay project and does some of the calcium imaging. Rachel is working on the project with the neuroinflammation in response to dopamine. Kaylin is my technician. She's fabulous and basically helps with everything. I want to thank all of my collaborators. The work in Nebraska is going to be done with Howard Fox. A lot of this work was done in collaboration with Joan Berman. Jonathan Javish has given me incredible advice about dopamine receptors for the entire time I've been working on the project, and his former graduate student, now a postdoc at NIDA, Hideaki, still helps me. I want to thank my funding for the National Institute of Drug Abuse and Drexel, and I will take questions.
Thank you for not making me ask.
All right, I'll be that guy. What about T cells? I know they express dopamine receptors.
What about
T cells?
So I have not looked at the effects on T cells. There are some people who have looked at dopamine's effect on HIV infection in T cell lines, like ACH2 cells, and they've seen that if you use extraordinarily high concentrations of dopamine, 100 micromolar, then you can reactivate HIV in latently infected T cell models. I don't know of any direct effects of HIV on of dopamine on HIV replication in T cells. It's possible I missed something, but I haven't seen it in the literature.
Thank you.
Other students?
Thank you so much for your talk. Exactly was the neurotransmitter that you just mentioned that you wanted to look into?
Oh, so I would look, I look into dopamine, but I'd also be interested in looking at serotonin, because there's a lot of therapeutics that affect serotonin. I'd be interested in looking at other neurotransmitters as well. Serotonin is the one that I often think about, because there are some studies to suggest that if you perturb the serotonergic system, you can interfere with HIV infection, although the studies go in opposite directions, so I'm not really sure what they're saying.
Okay.
My question would be, so you looked at macrophages on the whole, is there looked into the two different phenotypes of the macrophages, like M1 and M2, if there are any differences in the receptor?
Oh, I think that's an excellent question. So actually, one of the people that I am collaborating with, Dr. Spiller, is an expert in macrophage phenotypes. She has a genetic phenotyping procedure that we're going to use. I don't know how much I believe macrophage phenotypes are an issue. I don't know how much I believe macrophage phenotypes actually happen in vivo, but there's a lot of studies in vitro to show that you can polarize macrophages, and the field is moving in that direction, and so we are interested in looking to see. I did do some studies when I was at Einstein to see if dopamine could polarize macrophages in either direction, and I was never able to pick up any of the markers increased in response to dopamine, but the variation in markers was so wide that I don't think I would have been able to pick up anything even if something was happening, because the variability between people was quite high. So it's a very good question. I don't know the answer as to whether or not the phenotype has an effect, and it's something actually Rachel in my lab is currently looking into.
Why are you looking at dopamine receptors and not transporters?
So I'm looking at the receptors because when I started this, I wanted to see dopamine was having an effect, and I wanted to see what effect it was having, right? And so it mediates its effects mostly through the receptors. Now, it's possible that macrophages take up dopamine through the transporters or release dopamine and then take it back up. I'm in monoculture, and so the amount of dopamine that macrophages are going to release, if they release dopamine, isn't very much. Right? So the way that dopamine normally works in the brain is that dopamine is released, and then the effects of dopamine on the dopamine transporters are mediated by the reuptake of dopamine through the transporter. Right? So dopamine comes out, it affects the dopamine receptors, and then the transporter takes it away, and it stops affecting the dopamine receptors. This could be happening in macrophages, but the amount of dopamine that's probably being released is quite small. Some people have shown that PBMC released dopamine, but the amounts were 10 to the minus 9th, 10 to the minus 10th. That amount of dopamine doesn't seem to be affecting HIV replication. It's only the higher levels of dopamine that would come out of a neuron that would affect it. And so I was interested in the molecules that would respond to the dopamine coming out of a neuron. It's possible that macrophages take up dopamine and act as a sink, and then the dopamine as it gets into the macrophage could also have an effect. I was actually talking to Joris today about maybe looking with mass spec and see if macrophages do take up dopamine through the dopamine transporter. I have actually looked at the vesicular transport system in macrophages using the false fluorescent nucleotides, which I was mentioning before, but it doesn't seem like macrophages take up. False fluorescent nucleotides are a molecule that you can use to determine whether or not the vesicular transport system that is used to store dopamine in macrophages, basically it's VMAT2, so macrophages are taken back up by the dopamine transporter, and then once inside the neuron, they are then vesicularized and stored in vesicles by being transported through VMAT2. So if you can block the uptake of these false fluorescent nucleotides into the vesicle, then what you can do is you can say that the effect is happening through VMAT2. I was not able to see that, so I don't know that that system is active in macrophages. I do know the dopamine transporters are there, but I don't know that they're doing anything.
So you know where I'm going with this, right? So region of the brain are you more interested in?
So one of the reasons that I got started with this is because there was a lot of correlative and evidence suggesting that the basal ganglia was very strongly affected, right? There is a lot of dopamine in the caudate and the striatum, and so that would be the place that high levels of dopamine would increase HIV infection, and it seemed like there was increased HIV infection in that region, right? And so that's the area that people often talk about, and when you look at the macaques that were infected with SIV in the presence of high levels of dopamine, and you saw the exacerbated neuropathology, it was greatest in those regions, right? So the basal ganglia, specifically striatum and caudate, are probably what I would look for. You could talk about, so you're probably going to talk to me about where, well, please, I'm not going to speculate on what you're going to talk to me about. I'd like to hear.
I was trying to connect your earlier story of drug abuse, increase in drug abuse would lead to increase in HIV infection, so you're probably looking into the midbrain more ventrally than dorsally, mm-hmm. and that's where your dad story would probably fit in than the receptor story. So I was trying to see if you could connect all these dots together okay. rather than several different pieces. We could talk more about
that. Yeah, absolutely.
Hi, I'm just wondering how, or have you looked into the activation status of the macrophage and how this could affect your whole story?
What do you mean by activation status?
Whether or not the macrophages are activated.
So when you culture macrophages, they adhere to plastic and they all activate. So all my cells are activated.
Okay, but you haven't done anything with you know, beads or anything like that to see.
You mean, what, haven't
like, you haven't intentionally activated to them to see if this changes?
No, I haven't done it. I mean, they're cultured on plastic in the presence of MCSF, so they get to the state that they get to. I mean, some people call that M0, and then you can kind of change them to M1 or M2 from there. But that's the state that they're all in. So I don't, there's not necessarily, I haven't done, I mean, I have done some of this in the presence of things like LPS, but for other experiments. And, you know, doing things in the presence of LPS, you don't see very much at all because LPS swamps kind of everything. So I don't think that there's a particular activation state that I've looked at that's changed the effect of dopamine.
Any other questions? Okay, then Peter, thank you very much.